Thank you. Yes, I'm going to talk about weather and climate data. And this is mainly because I've been working as a climate researcher for the last 10 years. And about a year ago, I ended my academic career and started a job as a developer advocate at IBM. But it is really hard to actually stop working on climate data for me. So I just managed to squeeze a talk in about it in my current job, kind of combine what I know, what I've done, with what I do now. And you can find my slides here. I've been organized, so they're actually already on there. So you can just follow along. And so all the links and everything will be in there as well. Yeah. And I'm just going to start with the obvious, which is how most people use their weather data, which is basically on your phone, looking up the weather forecast, which I obsessively do multiple times a day. And I got a new iPad, so I added some drawings because I thought that was more fun than actually just Googling pictures of phones and things like that. So I just want to quickly go, how would you get a weather forecast using Python, using an API, and how to make a few plots and play around with it. And as you might have noticed, this is really a beginner's talk, so don't expect really advanced methods this today from me. So, as I said before, I'm going to do this in a notebook. And obviously, I would assume everyone is using Jupyter notebooks. I would like to see hands if you do not, actually. Cool, everyone. So, Jupyter notebooks, don't have to explain them at all. The data I'm going to use is from IBM, because they last year they took over the weather company, which gave my job. I got really excited because I like weather data, and now I'm allowed to talk about it in my job. So the weather company has a ridiculous amount of weather data, and they make that available quite easily through some APIs, which I'm going to use in this case. And it's easy to play with this, because you can log, create an account on Bluemix, and play around with the APIs and everything else. It's all free at the moment. And the other thing I'm going to use, and which I have to mention here, of course, is that I'm going to have run, I am doing all my analysis now in the IBM Data Science Experience, which is basically running your new Jupyter notebooks using a Spark kernels in the cloud, hosted in the IBM cloud, obviously. And this is where you can sign up for free as well. And if you really enjoy it, I can give you a code to extend your trial account if you contact me through Twitter or whatever. So this is nice. I like using this because I actually have no need to install anything local. And I find sometimes quite a pain to get Spark installed on my Mac. And here you get to play with a bit more resources. This is what it looks like. It's basically very much the same as other notebooks, except that you can collaborate with a lot of people within projects. So in this case, I am the only collaborator, but I work on other projects with my colleagues, so you can just share your notebooks with team people. And you can also have access to object store, which you can see at the bottom, which you can just easily access data. The rest, it basically looks exactly the same as a Jupyter notebook on your local machine, so I'm just going to stop with the screenshots now because they're quite annoying to look at, I find, difficult to read. Just going to show you how to basically get a weather forecast plot using a notebook. So this looks a bit different, I hope you can read it. So I start actually with JavaScript because I want to know my current location, and I couldn't find any Python function to do this. So this basically gets the current location of where you are. And the only problem with this is then you have to get it back to Python, which is possible, but you need a little function for it. So you write it back to Python, say, well, using this code, and then you know your latitude and longitude, which you then need to do an API request for this API. So you need two packages, request and JSON, to then do request for the API, which is in this case, as you can see, a 10-day forecast that I want. Get it back and get a JSON file back, all quite easy, which you can then print, have a look at what it looks like. And of course it is nested, which is always not my ideal, because I always have, it's just more annoying than to work with. And I left a lot of things out here, obviously. You get a forecast with different temperature, cloudiness, etc. And then for every 6 hours over the next 10 days. And there's some metadata. So latitude, longitude, and much more, which is not that interesting. And then, of course, it is a nice JSON file, but plotting this is just a lot easier if you use a pandas data frame. But because it was nested, this was my way of doing it, and I know it is ridiculous, looping over a JSON file and getting the each forecast out, basically. But anyway, this works. I had to take it out, turn it around, and concat, so stitch it all back together, basically, in a little loop. And the other thing that was important here is that because it is all time series, it's just a lot nicer to use a date time timestamp. So using the lambda function to convert all the dates for the forecast into something nice and easy. And as I said before, beginner's talk, it took me ages to understand lambda functions. I don't know why, but that's why I wanted to mention them one more time extra. They really work really cool with pandas data frames, because it's not always possible to run your function on a whole column, like I, for some reason, got used to in my head to do. But you can easily with lambda functions. And a little bit more cleaning, so drop everything I didn't need. And for some reason, the format was sometimes wrong. It read it as integers, not as numeric. And then I got a table, which is quite nice now to use. So I got for the next 10 days a table with for every 6 hours the precipitation, temperature, wind direction, and many more. And you can also see the icon code, which basically is relating to the icons, obviously, if it's a sun, a cloud, or any other combination that I come up with. Now, plotting this with Matplotlib, which is fine to do, but not always the quickest. And you need to, if you're working in a Python notebook, you have to include a line, the inline function, else you won't see a thing. In this case, I just wanted two simple plots, so I needed to say two rows, one column, and in this case, I'm gonna make a list, quick bar chart of the rain, defining the color exactly the same as in the top, the kind of pink color, doing a line chart for temperature. And that's what it looks like for Paris over the next 10 days, 8 by now, I think. So there is gonna be quite a lot of rain on the 14th, apparently. So this is quite really easy. And you can do the same for maps, you just have the same API. In this case, I did it for the UK, because that's where I live. And I just did quite a few cities, went through them, did an API request, and put all the data together. And then making a map with Matplotlib is something like this, and I did it kind of on purpose, because it always takes quite a lot of time to do this. So this is how you make a map. I'm sure if you look at the slides online, you might be able to see this. And it gives you this nice retro map, where on the left, the icons, I put them on GitHub so I can just access them through there, put them in a map, and on the right is the temperature. And I think I spent a whole afternoon on the colors of this one, because I just couldn't really stop. It was fun. But as you said, there was a lot of Matplotlib code going into that just super simple figure. And for this, this is now a year old. People in my team, and I have contributed a tiny little bit as well, mainly testing, a new package, a Python package called PixieDust, which we basically developed to give your Jupyter notebooks a sprinkle of magic, as they said. something like that. But it makes it has a lot of nice things included. The main thing is to make visualizations easier. So no need to write any code, just say display on your Spark or Pandas data frame. And you can play around with visualizations, which I like using just for exploring data, not so much if it has to be for real publication, but for just quick exploration is nice. And it also acts as a Scala, it's called Bridge, so you can use Scala code within your Python notebook and even without having to print back and forth between them, as I just showed before with JavaScript. And there's a few other things in bits and bobs in there just to make your life quite easy as a data scientist. And this is basically what it looks like, same data as before. In your notebook, you say display your data frame, and you come up. It comes with some menus. So it starts with just showing your data in a table. Through. I can't do this. That one. And then you get lots of options. If you want a bar chart, a line chart, pie charts, whatnot. In this case, it was just a simple line chart. And you can choose which renderer you want to use. So this is Bokeh, I think, but there's also Matplotlib, and for certain plots you can also use Seaborn. And then there's nice quick options to click around if you want a cluster or and things like that. Cool thing is you can do the same for maps, because a line chart is not that hard to write the code down, but for maps, obviously it is. In this case, you just need to convert your data quickly into a data frame as well. So here I just had the city and latitude, longitude, and a temperature in one data frame, and then saying display my map, my data frame. I get a map straight away, no other code needed. And last week they started adding a few things, so now we have dark backgrounds or satellite backgrounds. You can change the color around, and there's a slider of how big you want the map to be. And zooming in and out is easy as well. So this is very much in development, obviously. This is a year old. Just luckily we get time to do this in our jobs, which is nice. IBM seems to really support this effort. And if you're really interested in visualization and things like that, we love to have contributions for this package, adding more different options and whatnot. And the other thing I want to quickly show, again, Pixie Dust. This is even more new. It was launched this month, I think. The latest version is Pixie Apps, where you can basically make interactive dashboards within a notebook. So using a bit of HTML, CSS, you can start playing around with buttons and things that move and interactive visualizations. This is just an example of a Twitter feed that then in real time analyzes the sentiment of each tweet and plots it in a few graphs. But of course, there's many, many, many others we're working on at the moment. Back to weather, because I kind of drifted away from that, I think. But I had to squeeze Pixie Dust in my talk, I thought. So where does this weather data all come from? And now I go back to my previous life in academia. Obviously, it comes from observations and models. Two things. If you want to go into the past, it's quite easy. Most of it is observed. And into the future, you need a model or some statistics. So again, this is pre-UK based, but I know that Meteo France has quite a lot of data as well. Or there's many other places you can find weather data for free. So observational data is like, for instance, temperature, humidity, the wind speed, the air pressure, rainfall, and radiation, all these kind of things. They're just observed all over the world, many locations. And this was a really promising map from the Met Office in the UK. And then this is the data that I actually provide. So that was okay. All right. So that's the top link. And then if you're obviously interested in different locations, There's the Weather Company API, which you have to pay for, and or to get the free one through Bluemix. And KNMI, the Dutch Weather Service, has a lot of data, which is in the Climate Explorer, which have a nice interface. Or ECMWF, they run and combine lots of different data sets, which is a really huge amount of data that you can get find there. So there's lots to find quite easily. But as you saw, the ones I just showed before, they're all points. And weather normally comes in maps, and the models, they do also work on a grid. So there's a lot of conversions between these points and the and the grids, etc. So basically, this is your problem. You have the temperature at a few locations, but you want to have a grid because that's how you need it for some reason. It's quite easy actually to do this, obviously. You just interpolate it, and SciPy has an easy function to this. You find the grid data from scipy.interpolate, import it, and have to define the grid you want to know the temperature for, let's say. So the X and the Y between the latitude and longitude, in this case, and which you then just mesh into two D arrays. And then just say grid data, go to over my grid and your points. And I just added a few, three different options you can use, the nearest neighbor, linear or cubic. And there's many, many more, but this was like me being a bit lazy. This is also quick and easy. It gives you three maps of the UK, and in this case, I did not spend a lot of time on the colors. So the first time, the nearest method is just the nearest neighbor. So just for each grid cell, it finds the nearest point, and which clearly doesn't work for temperature because it's a continuous field. It looks just silly. And if you just start increasing the function, adding more variables, so going from linear to cubic, you see you can get a bit of more better maps. But way better would be to use kriging, which just keeps finding the smoothest surface possible. So now we have maps. Okay, I swapped two things around. So now we have a map, and now actually, how do you store it, and how can you work with this data? What most the Met Office and most climate data is stored in NetCDF binary files. So it gives you a nice way to store lots of data, but at the same time, it's also a little bit annoying to read it in again and do calculations on. So basically, you have latitude, longitude for all these files, and then some values. And then they stack them on top of each other. So for instance, each layer is a different variable or could be a different time step, a different hour, things like that. But it is actually easy because there's a package for that as well. NetCDF 4 Python package, which you can just easily use. And together with NumPy, it's nice to easy to work with these kind of files. So in this case, I downloaded the crew NetCDF file from the crew data, where this data is basically using all the points around the world, and they interpolated it into grid data sets. And there have been a bit of issues, obviously, about how they've done that, because it basically this data is used to say how has temperature changed globally over the world, etc., etc. And you can imagine that there was a lot of statistics involved here, and choosing which points are right. If the observations are right, how do I interpolate it? And I'm sure they didn't use the simple methods I just showed. But if you just get a file from there, then you can read it in and have a look around what a file looks like. So obviously, this was a NetCDF4 file, and it contains a latitude, a longitude, and certain dimensions. So that basically gives you now a 3D array to play around with. And unfortunately, Gridded dataset has not been added to. And Pixie does yet, which is one of the things I want. So maybe someone might be interested in doing this. So I needed Matplotlib to make a map out of this and Basemap to make it all look nice and et cetera, et cetera. So the first thing you want to, if you want to do a global map, for instance, you need to define the base map. So what's the area of latitude, longitude you want to plot, and also which projection you want to use. There's many, many different ones. And I always think that the mill looks nicest. And then going back to the drawing, I just sliced one time step, the zero, here. So the first time step, the first map of this data set. And the interesting thing is, if you work with this kind of data and you try to compare different data sources, they are always upside down or not, and never compare. So it's always one big puzzle to get your maps the right way, or you have to move them 180 degrees because Australia is in the middle and things like that. So that's what I had to do here. I had to shift it. I did not have to turn it upside down in this case. And then, as before, I had to mesh it into an X and Y coordinates. I can go through this quickly, but you have to choose your colors, your legend, etc., etc. And then say P color mesh and you plot your map. It gives you this. So this is quite a lot of effort, I think, always. So this should be an easy way. And I might not have found it, and I would love to hear it if I've always done this way too hard. So this was all measurements, really, or data sets based on measurements, things like that. But forecasts and predictions are really where the interesting things start, I think. So these all come from climate models. And I want to basically explain a climate model with this slide, which is quite ambitious, I think. But a climate model, basically, it starts with an initial condition of the atmosphere, and it is consists of a large grid where the energy and water and CO2 balances for each grid cell are solved with differential equations. And then there's a lot of boundary conditions. Of course, there's the atmosphere at the top, there's the ocean at the bottom, and there's also the land surface itself with vegetation, which has a lot of processes and a lot of interactions with the atmosphere. And then within the atmosphere, you have clouds and things like that that also make things complicated. And all these things are really just based upon observations of these individual processes, and then they were given all parameters. So there's lots and lots of parameters that you can play around with in these models, which I've been studying in my last postdoc. Things you can then do, because you have so many parameters that you just don't really know anymore where to start, is take these models and just start running them all with the same initial condition. So they all start, in this case, in 1850, with the same in the same state. And then each of these lines, you just have a different parameter set. And just keep playing around with that and see what the uncertainty is. So people try to understand how this kind of interactions work, how to choose the best one. I still don't really know. But here you can see that if you just change the parameters of the atmosphere in red, that's the variation you get. Only cloud parameters and things like that. If you change the parameters of the land surface and the vegetation, forests and trees, you get quite a bit different uncertainty. And then if you go for the ocean, which is the blue one, it's a little less. But if you add all these things up, it just starts to be a temperature increase over the next century can go really anywhere. The other thing you can do with these climate models, and I forgot to mention, I couldn't even run these on my local machine. These were all run because they're all fully coupled on the supercomputer in the Met Office, which makes it really hard and quite expensive to do these kind of experiments. And then this is a different kind of experiment you can do with the good models, the climate models, which I have to say I just borrowed borrow this link because they explain it really well. So here's what they try to do, is try to explain the global temperature, the increase over the last, well, let's say a bit more than a century, from observations. So this is how the temperature increased. And what they've done here is they kept everything constant, so CO2 concentration didn't increase, there were no volcanoes, no changes in land, nothing at all. And then they did change them one by one to see which actually caused this increase in temperature. And here they only changed the natural forcings. So I can't read that. So the solar variations and the volcanoes, etc., and tried to explain the increase in temperature, and they clearly failed. And well, yeah, I think you can guess what's come next. If you then start adding the human factors, like CO2 increase and land use changes, you get a pretty good fit with this. And if you combine these two together, you get also all the wiggles quite right. So that's another thing you can use these climate models for. And then I really come to my last point, is this is all quite a bit of the background, what happens in research and simple APIs. But the thing I'm now working on is what can I actually use this data for? Because this is quite theoretical and although fun. There's quite a lot of things, I would say, because it's important in insurance, the weather. If you want to, that's more of a long-term change. If the weather changes, it's likely to change based on models in the future, more rain, etc., you probably should not go and live there, or the insurance company might decide to increase the amount you have to pay for your insurance. Energy sector, they use it a lot already, for instance, to predict how much solar or wind power they can generate, and then how, of course, for how much they have to sell that and things like that. And even short and the retail as well. So how do you stock your supermarket with what kind of products, things like that. And as I am quite new to this bit of the weather and what to do with it, I started exploring these kind of things. And in my job, I am supposed to use always open data because it's nice to give a demo, but then nobody can ever repeat it. That's quite useless. So this is a nice example I found was the traffic collision data of New York, because it's huge. There's over the last, 5-6 years, there's like a million traffic collisions, which they have recorded and have quite a lot of details from. And you can find that data here. And after I cleaned this up a little bit, again, this time I used a Spark data frame. Don't know why really, but that seemed to make more sense because the data got a little bit bigger and was easy to read. So in this case, after cleaning it up, I had like 800,000 traffic collisions since 2014. That's what it was. And for each of these collisions, I know the data time, where it is, latitude, longitude, and also how many people were injured or killed, and what kind of vehicles, etc. So this is quite an interesting one. And this is the same map again. And I thought, because obviously weather might have a big effect on this kind of thing, how can I figure that one out statistically, or even with machine learning, or whatever. And so I started looking into temperature data and all the weather for New York. And as I had the access to the API, I just thought, oh, I can just do an API call for 800,000 points. But then I thought that's just silly because I'm just playing. So let's just do this more sensible and compare a bit of data just for a few weather stations in New York. And they're quite similar, really. So I probably could do just one time series. New York is not that big. And the temperature, as you can see, between the five boroughs is not that different. It's not really the same for rainfall because there's a lot more variation in there. So I think I am going to introduce already an error by just doing this. And the first thing I thought, I'm just going to merge it. It's quite nice and easy. I know the date. I know the look of the two data sets and just say, merge my, I converted the pandas data frame first because that's just easier. Then merge them by time. So merge as of, and there you can select, well, the left and your right data frame and do this by time, which I didn't know, even know it existed until I started looking for this, which I think is a nice, easy, cool function. Works really nice, but then I had like totally useless data set because I had like random points all over time with a bit of weather here and there. So I couldn't do any statistics on that because I only had. So my next thing, what I decided was to do, just summarize it all and get really nice data sets, time series. So for here, I just jumped over each hour, I think, yeah. Each hour between a start and an end time, and find the number of collisions and summarize that, so how many persons were injured and killed, and do the same for weather data. So actually get a very nice time series that makes sense, so you can see if the rain increases, how many actual collisions were there and things like that, instead of just my almost binary file of always one collision at some certain temperature. Made no sense at all. And I am still working on this. This is how far I got. So this is going to turn into a blog where I'm just going to explore the data further and then see if it makes a difference. And I'm actually not that confident yet that I'm going to find anything, as always. But this is where you can then find the results that I am going to probably write up very soon in the next week or two. And that is pretty much it. There was a bit of a flavor of climate data, which is basically moving between time series, maps, and shifting data around and comparing different maps and data sets. And there's a lot more to it, obviously, but this was really the beginning of working with data. And a few references, if you're interested in especially PixieDust, I have to mention the third one, because that's where a lot of work is going at the moment. And also, most notebooks I work on, they're all on GitHub. Thank you.